is the deal with Crystal Palace? Are they the archetypal mid-table club? What does their future hold? Is Roy Hodgson going to be there next season? Welcome to the Big Match Preview. It's AFC Bournemouth travelling to Selhurst Park to play Palace on Saturday. My name's Sam Davis.
My name's Tom Jordan.
This is Back of the Net, and it's a fixture, Tom, between two sides that are going to be fairly relaxed.
Yeah, nice and relaxed. Like you say, both flirt with relegation a little bit, us probably more so. But we're both out of it now, and it should be just a good fixture with no fear and all that good stuff. So, yeah, let's see. But I think both sides are probably just relieved and calm right now.
We were flirting with relegation, as were they, but I think their series of results that they got recently, we're going to go over them later in the show, but it certainly took them out of the mire sooner than what it did with us. So after coronation weekend, it's time to go to the Palace. Selhurst Park is the venue this weekend, as we know. Before we talk about Palace, and we've got loads to say on Palace, to all those that went on Tuesday, thank you very much. It was the Carling Local Legends evening at the Brunswick in Charminster. And look, we gave them a little cheeky second look at the start as well, because we didn't have one on this channel. We'll talk briefly about the previous game against Chelsea. But what a lovely evening it was at Green King with Carling and the main man himself, the local legend, Steve Fletcher. What a good night, eh?
Yeah, it was a great night, mate. Yeah, please, thank you to everyone that come, really. It was really good. I mean, Fletcher's class anyway, he's golden, he makes it flow nicely, chats really well, so asked him a few questions, got some good nuggets in there, because Fletcher's told a lot of stories, so we tried to manoeuvre it a little bit differently, and I thought we'd done it well, mate. So yeah, I really enjoyed the night. It was enjoyable to just chat with Fletch and see loads of supporters. It was great. And who was it? Was it Ken that won the shirt?
Yeah, Ken Clayton.
Yeah, well, brilliant. Ken. Won a match-worn Phil Billing shirt. So he had a good night. But yeah, really enjoyable, mate. It was a good way to start off the week.
It certainly was. So yeah, thank you to all that came. And you that did come will know what Fletch's favourite Tesco's meal deal is. There's a reason to come to the next event, I'm absolutely certain. Right then, Palace. It's the second time we've played in this season. Shall we relive the first time, mate?
If we have to. One of the worst, wasn't it?
It's so bad.
I think
it was bad.
Yeah, if Palace fans aren't aware, I think that's up there with Southampton at home. I think that's one of the, when people say the season's from the really bad games, that's one that sticks out. Nothing against Palace, because Palace got the job done quite comfortably, but we were just felt we were really, really poor in that game, and it was a time where we felt, oh, so this is a big game for us at home, we could be able to get some points here, and we were awful, I thought.
Yeah, we didn't really turn up, and Gary Neil himself, who was in still, that was his first Premier League home game as permanent manager, and he described it as the worst I've seen. And that was one where we had Bill Foley, the new owner, Michael B. Jordan was there as well, so there was pyrotechnics and flamethrowers and all sorts of fanfare to greet the players, but sadly that fanfare didn't carry on the pitch, and it was a really turgid performance. It was one that Patrick Vieira was in charge, of course, for the visitors, and we'll talk about how it turned out for him eventually. But yeah, one of our weaker performances. But it's fair to say, Tom, that both sides, as the year has progressed, have improved. We've got the same manager, they've got a different one.
Yeah, I think we kind of both start the season pretty much as expected, and then for whatever reason both teams kind of dipped at a similar point, and then they've both come out the other side, one because of change of manager, as you say, and one was sticking with their manager after the early change of Scott Parker. So yeah, probably a lot of parallels actually. But yeah, we'll go into obviously what Palace did and stuff, but yeah, we've both improved, and as you say, both in a comfortable position now, and both probably would have taken it.
Of course, we've made some January signings, as Cherries fans will know, so Crystal Palace fans, a little bit of background, but this was the side that we were putting out, and there's a fair few that will be involved on Saturday's lineup, but you know, there are some that will not be. For instance, Mark Travers, we've of course got Neto now, Zamora not there, Lewis Cook not involved as well, Jaden Anthony is on the fringe, and then Kiefer Moore only tends to come on as a plan B, really, not really as a starter. So certainly a different lineup. And when you see the stats from that game as well, well, that told its own story. We had more of the ball. That never happens when we win. Never.
Gonna repeat that again, that when we have more possession, we normally lose the game, I always think. So, yeah. And it was a really frustrating game. I think they got relatively early goal, and it was Ayu header, and he was like one of the smallest on the pitch or something. And I think he'd had a really bad run as well in terms of goals. And yeah, it typically popped up against us. But I never really felt like we looked like scoring, to be honest, in that game. I thought they were very comfortable. And to be fair to Palace, it was a decent away performance from them, I thought.
Yeah, really was. Okay, so here's the league table right now then. And it's fair to say we're comfortable. Not mathematically. Crystal Palace, however, are. They've got nothing to worry about. We just need a point. But, I mean, really, there is, I think, between Leeds and Leicester, if they both don't win, then that pretty much secures it. I think one of them is playing at lunchtime.
So I was just about to say, Leeds are playing Newcastle, so if our ex-manager Eddie could do us a favour, if they go and beat Leeds, I think we are there anyway. But, yeah, it would be a nice feeling going into it. But, yeah, both teams, as I say, mate, got into this fixture when probably not too long ago you thought this could be a big game, but now it's kind of something or nothing for both teams.
And check out the form table. Look at us. Look at us. We're in fourth and Palace are in sixth.
Wolves in fifth.
I know. What's going on? Yeah. But that's what tends to happen because towards the end of campaign, certain teams just get a certain run and, you know, that's ultimately secured our status. But both teams should be very proud of that.
Yeah, definitely. And I think Palace fans would probably be a bit wary of the fact that in all that run, it's been on the road for us. I think we've won... Is it three away games on the bounce? Tottenham, Leicester and Southampton. I mean, imagine if we've got four away wins in a row. So yeah, we beat Leeds at home, but it's actually been our home form. Lost to Brighton, lost to West Ham, lost to Chelsea. Hasn't been as good. It's been us on the road. So that's certainly something to be upbeat about. And I'm kind of happy in a weird way that we've, in the three games, we've got two away. Because I think we've been better on the road. So we'll see if that comes to play again, mate.
And look, we could still have our best ever season. 46 points is our... obviously, that would be tough, especially with Man United at home. But this is what the baseline track table looks like as well. And it's fair to say that anyone who's on zero and above is doing well. Had we secured 3 points against Chelsea, that would have been +3 because they are... That's not a default, because when you get a default, that's zero. But because they are outside of the so-called other 14, that's the big six, according to the media. Chelsea are one of them. Therefore, we didn't get deducted any points for a home loss there. And, you know, briefly, speaking of that home loss, Tom, I felt a bit disappointed or disheartened, frustrated, you could say. But really, when I look back, especially at the highlights, it actually wasn't a bad performance. And really, it was just a case of one clinical side and one that wasn't. I think for the bulk of the game, we were on top. But it's just those last 10, 15 minutes, we just sort of switched off a little bit and our head seemed to drop, but we had chances.
We did, and I think there was a big chance for Dango, weren't there, from a header at 1-1. But yeah, I thought there was nothing really in the game. If anything, we looked more like the score. I think at 1-1, if you'd offered both teams a draw, I don't think either would have taken it. I think both teams felt it was quite an open game. And weirdly, because we've been frustrated about sitting back in certain games this season, we didn't in this one because we had nothing to lose. It didn't really matter. So I was quite happy that we kept going for it. We ended up losing the game. But if it had got to the last 15 and we had sat back and lost 2-1, we wouldn't have been happy. I quite like that we just tried to play and tried to cause them problems. And yeah, just it was the difference was the subs. I said it a few times. They brought on Sterling and João Felix, and that one of them scored. One of them got a couple of assists in there. So yeah, it was what it was. But yeah, I don't think anyone was really disheartened after the game. As you said, mate, I think it was a bit like, oh, we could have got something there. But really, we were kind of all happy and it was a decent atmosphere in the crowd. So, yeah, it was what it was, as I say, mate. But, I took a lot of positives out of it, to be honest.
I wouldn't say any of the players were on the beach or anything, but we at back of the net probably were, because, yes, we did do the fan cams. But as for the vlog, I mean, it was Tiggs's birthday. So on Saturday night, we went out and celebrated that. And then I think the vlog I ended up putting out on Monday because there was just no... No obvious hunger for it. There wasn't really any hunger for the fan cams either, really. It was just... You know, people saying the obvious things, really, I suppose. It was just one of those games where I think we're all just so relieved to be over the line now. Now we could just relax a little bit. But as I think it'll be quite interesting these next three games, how Gary O'Neill plays it. And obviously, you know, we want to finish as strong as we possibly can. Maybe we can get 3 points at Palace. Look, safe travels if you are going up. It's a nightmare. Train strikes. The roads are going to be jam-packed. You're going to have to use buses if you're going around London. The tube doesn't go so far as Selhurst, so you can get as close as you can and then maybe tram it across or get a bus. But
oh, I love London.
You love London, don't you? Yeah, but unfortunately, the RMT strikes mean that you... I mean, we had our trains booked. And it was only the other day that I realised, oh, I can't actually use them because a refund landed in my account. Like, what's going on here? But sadly, no beers on the train, and we'll just have to have beers in the pub, mate, or lattes, whatever you fancy, mate.
Yeah, I might have a couple.
Yeah, it's going to be a nice day anyway. 18 degrees Celsius, 18.
Oh, well, so,
that's practically t-shirt weather. I might even just wear one layer. Screw it. Ooh. One layer Davis. There's going to be a little bit of sun. It's going to be overcast, but you know what? It's going to be a nice day. Leaving plenty of time for it. Mm. Make sure you've got your parking sorted. But it should be a good one. And Palace fans, if you're watching, we've got four reasons why you should subscribe to this channel. Firstly, there's a video out as soon as the full-time whistle goes, pretty much.
Yeah, fan cams. So any Palace fans, if you see us, more than welcome to come over as well. Just that instant reaction after the game from fans outside the ground. Then we get into the old vlog that you have to edit up, get that sorted from our day and from the game. Some nice bit of footage there. Then we'll probably do a second look and discuss the game in further detail. Go over different bits and bobs from the game. And then obviously because it's an away game, we'll have to rate the away day. We've got a little tier list going on. Mm. Only yourselves and Everton to go in that tier list. So see how you shape up, because it's one that I've been there a few times. So I'm really not sure how it's going to fare, because there's certain things about the away day where I think, oh, it's sometimes the view can be a bit restricted and London's a bit of a nightmare with these strikes. But then there's other bits that I think is what normally, if you see if they live up to it, one of the best home atmospheres. Yeah. So there's a few bits I really enjoy about Palace. So yeah, looking forward to seeing what it's like.
Yeah, really hoping you can join what Newcastle at the top of the tier list. Palace fans, there's a reason to subscribe. And look, we appreciate your support, so hit the like button as well. Right, so let's just go through Palace's results. We won't go through the whole season, of course, but we'll do it, say, since March. And there were a series of results that that culminated in Patrick Vieira being relieved of his duties. I think it was before the Arsenal game, which they ended up losing 4-1, but it was a 1-0 loss at Villa Park. They then lost at home to Man City, which, you know, no great shakes really. Losing 1-0 at their nearest and dearest Brighton Hove Albion, and then the sacking 4-1 over Arsenal. But then things started to change, mate. And of course, Roy Hodgson was appointed at the start of April, and They had a pretty good April, didn't they, really?
They didn't. You've only got to look at that and say, well done to Roy, because, they start off, they beat Leicester, which was a big win at the time, absolutely hammered Leeds 5-1, which was a real statement.
At half-time, they were 1-0 down,
yes,
weren't they?
Yeah, they definitely went behind. Then winning at Southampton, so they were big wins. They got the point against Everton, and then lost to Wolves and fell off a little bit, but they kind of already got them results in the bag. Really good win over West Ham, that was a good game, 4-3, and then just lost to Tottenham. But yeah, I feel for Vieira a little bit. I'm sure Palace fans kind of agree, because if you look at them fixtures like you did briefly, the defeats, they're against Brighton, they're tough games.
And look at the wins that they've got here. Saints, Leeds, Leicester, we know how to beat those sides.
Yeah, and you've still got to get the win, so Roy deserves all the credit. But from Vieira's point of view, he probably goes, I wish I had a crack at them games, because I was playing. I think the problem was, if you go just scroll down onto them games, the Villa, City, Brighton were in defeats. They haven't scored a goal.
Yeah.
And I think that was their worry a little bit as well, is they weren't scoring goals. And that's always a bit more of a fear if you think, oh, God, we're not even scoring. But I felt for Vieira a little bit, because I think he's a good coach and I think he'll have a good career. But I could see why, you know, they were thinking, we need to just get some results in, get a steady head in. And they did that with Roy, and they've reaped the rewards in the end, mate. So, yeah, because they have got talented players. They have got really talented players, and he's managed to just get the best out of them. So, yeah, credit to him.
Whenever I tune into the sports bar, used to be with Goldstein and Cundy, whenever they would mention Roy Hodgson, it would play the dinosaur sound effect in Jurassic Park. But you know what, mate? He's 75 years old.
Yeah, fair.
Fair play to him. He obviously still, you know, keeps abreast of the Premier League and football in general. His knowledge is unbelievable, but he can still get a tune out of these players. But What's the long-term plan for... I mean, it's not going to be a three-year Hodgson contract, is it? Like, what's the deal, do you think?
I think initially the deal would have been, Roy, you love the club, we love you here, come in, save us. A bit Warnock's done it at Huddersfield, hasn't he? And then walk away and we'll have a plan. But what happens with that is then when he does do well, you go, oh, could he do another season? Do you know, so it'd be really interesting to see what one Palace fans actually think and also what the club decide to do and what Roy wants to do. Because I've seen, you know, just going back to the Warnock kind of comparison, they've all been like, oh, come on, do you fancy it? And he's gone, no, I only do the end of the season now with my age and stuff. So it might be similar with Roy. But yeah, it's an interesting one. I think when they've got Roy in, they're already planning behind the scenes. I would have thought so.
But, you know, like Pat Vieira was going to be there for a start, wasn't he?
He was. It's will be an interesting one. There's a few young upcoming managers that they might look at because they obviously want some sort of long-term thinking. You've seen that a few times with Palace. They're trying to get someone long-term. I remember when they got like De Boer in and he got sacked for like five games or whatever it was. They're trying to, but then they're just, as soon as it gets a little bit nervy, go and get an old school head and keep them up. It's worked to a degree.
And that's it. And they're always going to be a side. I mean, I said, are they the archetypal, yes, easy for me to say, mid-table side? But they're always going to be there or thereabouts flirting with relegation. So, I don't think they ever went in the mix. I don't think they ever went into the bottom three, but it's just...
They acted before they got in it, didn't they?
Yeah, they did. And, you know, to be fair, they have reaped the rewards, but... What's their ceiling? What is their ceiling?
I think that's what's tough. That's tough for Palace, maybe even ourselves next season. I mean, probably not quite yet, but definitely tough for a team like Palace, like Wolves, them sort of teams as you go, right, we need to stay in the Premier League. That's the bread and butter. We've got to do that. But then they look at Brentford, Brighton, Fulham, trying to get into Europe, Villa even. I know they're a bigger club. And they kind of think, oh, can we take that next step? And it's really difficult.
I wonder what's holding them back then. I wonder what's holding them back.
Yeah, I'm not sure. I'm really not sure. Because they have got good players. Maybe they're still... I would say they are, when you look at their squad, they're where I expect them to be, if I'm honest. I mean, if Palace fans disagree, let me know. Because they have got some real stars in there. But also some really young players that I'm sure we'll get onto that they'll hope will progress with the club. But as I said, with Brentford, Brighton, Fulham, they're the three main ones. You go, could that be Palace next year? Yeah, could be. Could it be Wolves next year? Yeah, potentially. So these sort of teams just want to get to that level. Yeah. But then if they start sinking, Wolves are exactly the same, getting Lopetegui, then they get to that default of just stay in the league.
Yeah.
So yeah, it's kind of going to be like that for a little bit. But then equally, as I say, I know they're a slightly bigger club, but Villa started the season awful, but then they went and got a top manager and now they are pushing for Europe. So it can happen. But I don't know, Palace are always a team that I quite like and I always think, that'd be a great job for someone because if someone can just, they've got a bit of quality, a little run, they could get on seventh for that.
Absolutely.
So see who does it for them.
And they've got talent littered throughout their side and throughout the show. I'm sure we're going to mention a few names. Let's start with the keeper. The save percentage. Look, we've got our own Neto that's up for player of the season in many fans' hearts, I suspect.
Yes.
It's going to be him or Meps, me, really, probably.
Billing, maybe.
I mean, Billing, yeah. Solanke could get a mention. I don't know.
We always give it to keepers, so.
Yeah, exactly. But look, you know, Neto there on 72.7%, but, you know, Guaita as well, 72.4%.
And then he got an injury.
Yeah.
So they brought in Sam Johnson.
Exactly, yeah,
so
that's
right. Yeah, so you're thinking, oh, they've lost Guaita, that might be different. And he's done really, really well, and I probably expect him to stay in because I think Guaita is back now, but they've stuck with Johnson because he's done really well. And That's really handy, you know, you've got two good goalkeepers. I think
they do seem to have a good spine of the
yes, side, that's a fair shout. I think I like the centre halves, Anderson and Gueye. I think, like you say, they have got a very good spine there. And yeah, they've just got some reliable players with a little bit of flair in there as well. I quite like the shape of the squad. Maybe it's just a bit of consistency that they need to find. And maybe that's because there are a lot of young players.
We were taking a look at the average positions of the last four games and it's clear that they magnetised to the left flank. And of course, Wilfried Zaha, apparently he's going to cry in a minute. These are all the chants that I'm sure he gets week in, week out. But they've got a number of stars, haven't they, really?
Yes.
He's one of them, like Eze as well, Elise.
Yeah.
And
yeah,
as we look at some more of the other 14 stats as well, you can see that Elise and Eze here,
great
in
play,
terms of the chances created, absolutely superb players.
What they've done really well is they've got hold of them before they've kind of made their name, which means that plenty of big clubs are probably going to sniff. But they're both kind of youngsters that they've taken the punt on, and now there's going to be big teams flirting with them. So they've got them before their peak. So that's what I'm kind of saying. You look at the players, I think a lot of quality there, but then maybe because of that youthfulness, there's that consistency is difficult, but both of them I really rate. Eze is a top, top player. And if you think them two and Zaha behind the front man, it's a lot of flexibility there. There's a lot of real rawness, but a lot of pace as well. So yeah, they're really talented footballers. It's just getting that consistency out of them, mate. And even at the back, Guay we've seen get into England squads, as well as Mitchell, the left back. Anderson's a good player. So they have got really good players. So the more I talk about it, the more I think, I can maybe see why they want to kind of look up rather than be flirting with relegation. I do appreciate that.
Of course, earlier in the season, before the season began, I think we were looking at every single Premier League club thinking there's going to be some Cherries links with most. I think Wolves was one of the only clubs where we couldn't find an obvious Cherries link. But that's apparently there's a couple with Palace, is that right?
There's a couple in the same position.
Go on.
Their right back will probably be either Joel Ward.
Oh, yeah.
Who we had on loan, who was there during the Great Escape under Eddie, but he actually was injured when Eddie come in. And then we also, Nathaniel Clyne, who we had on loan from Liverpool. It was obviously at Southampton as well, but they're the two right back options, are both ex-Cherry. So, yeah, interesting little link there. Both players that were okay with us, but never really hit the levels, and probably both that they would say are steady, but they would like to maybe advance on that in the fullback position, because neither of them are young anymore. But yeah, both solid pros, mate.
Yeah, both solid pros. Right, should we check out the head-to-head record? Tell you what, we'll just do it since the Premier League, because we have had a fair few fixtures within pre-Premier League, but it's fair to say it's a mixed bag. But we have had some joy. Our first win was in 2016, February. Do you remember that night? That was a night game, wasn't it?
Felt massive as well, mate. I'm going to be wearing the pink shirt at the weekend. I remember us winning in the pink.
They scored first, didn't they?
Yeah, little stat that I know is from that game, I think it was from that game onwards, 4 games in a row, Scott Dan scored against us.
Really?
He's a centre-back.
Oh my God.
That fortunately is now at Reading, I believe. Yeah. He's not there anymore anyway. God. But he scored a header in that game. Then he scored in the next fix. Then he scored in the... It was unbelievable. He's a centre-half. But they took the lead. And then I remember Puey scored a nice goal and Benikofobi. And it was a big night for us. It really was. That was like, oh my God, we're going to stay up. I remember it was a big, big win. But that's the only win I've seen at Selhurst.
And that's the only... Yeah, I think that's the only one.
Definitely in the Premier League.
We did beat him at Dean Court.
Yes.
Of course, David Brooks scoring. Yes. Junior Stanislas, I think.
Was it a penalty? I feel like we got a penalty.
It was a Junior Stanislas penalty, like late on. Yes. In front of the Ted McDougall.
Both them wins were evening games.
Yes, you're right. There was another win against them, which was an evening game.
God, the penalty shootout.
Yeah.
In the cup. Begovic, the hero, yeah.
Should we watch a bit of the Pens?
Oh, yeah, let's do it.
Come on.
God.
Oh, man. Why am I nervous?
Ted,
oh, Begovic.
Now it's keeper against keeper at 10 apiece. All the outfield players who finished the game.
His distribution has been all right tonight. So now it's Begovic against Can he distribute Tennessee? This? He scored against Boric, remember? So he's got goal scoring. Oh,
fucking Begovic.
And the keeper against keeper scenario finally causes one to blink.
I haven't got faith that he's going to save it.
No chance.
Now, so Begovic has to put that disappointment behind him pretty quickly and see if he can return the favour.
It's a good last game for us, isn't it?
Yeah, you know what? But a lot of people wanted this, though, didn't they? Oh, my God, he's put over! What the hell?
Oh, that's been
what was he thinking? What was he thinking?
Blazed it over the crossbar.
Come on, Brooksy.
Brooks against Tennessee.
That's better. That's better than your first one, mate. Much higher into the net. Right, come on, Asmir, save a penalty.
Yeah, he's not save as he can save one
home. 11-10.
Oh, Sam Milijevic, he never misses. I mean, I can't say his name, but he never misses a penalty. Never misses a penalty.
Keep the same order as we had, of course, earlier at the original shooter.
Begovic's going to turn into a hero, isn't he? After I just called him out.
Cut Begovic.
Usual
sidestep.
Yes! Come on, Begovic!
Yes! What a keeper! I said to you, didn't I? I can always rely on Asmir Begovic.
Oh my God, that's brilliant! I mean, we didn't want to get through, but...
Oh, I'm going to sit now.
What a save!
What a keeper. I mean...
What? You know what? Strong left arm as well. Strong left arm.
No less than 25 million for Begovic for me.
No less than 25 mil!
Oh, can we cut the bit where I just had a go at him for ruin everything? Yeah, yeah.
So there was you... saying, you Begovic, sign him up, you know, give him what he needs after moments before.
Yes.
But I tell you what an interesting penalty shootout. But yeah, that was, what was it, 14-13 or 13-12?
Yeah, because it was Jason Tindall, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah, it was Jason Tindall. So it was, and obviously it was COVID, that's why we were watching it. Yeah, yeah, sure. But yeah, it's a weird one because, like I say, that's the only Premier League win we won at Selhurst, like I mentioned. We got the 2-2 that I remember Defoe scoring a screamer.
Yes.
We got battered there a few times. I remember losing that horrible one. where they went down to 10 men. Sacco.
I was about to say, what's the last game we played against? So that was the first Amazon televised fixture, correct, I think, since they had the contract. And you're right, it was 1-0.
Jeffrey Schlupp, I believe, scored. But yeah, we were awful that day. So yeah, you look at it and you get the one very good. I remember going there, the last game of the season, sorry, where Lerma scored a screamer.
Yeah, 5-3, wasn't it?
5-3, even Joel Knibbs scored.
Yeah.
I think Jack Simpson scored an own goal off the top of my head. But we lost 5-3, but because it was the last game of the season, it was like party time. Yeah. So every time I go to Selhurst, I've seen like Defoe Worldie win. Yes, we lost, but I was partying anyway. So I always feel like I've enjoyed it, weirdly.
Defoe's Worldie, though, hang on, that was just before half time, wasn't it?
Yes.
So there's no chance you saw it.
I missed it.
Of course he did. He missed his goals, Palace fans. Yeah. See, you know, like seeing the vlog, if we score in and around half time, he won't be.
I missed the Lerma goal of the season as well.
Yeah. Oh my god.
Yeah, I missed that as well.
What did they do in January, mate? Because they spent big money on one player, I think.
Yeah, Hamada, I think his name is. He's a young player that's coming through. So I think he come in. But Lokonga was an interesting signing because he's playing a little bit for Arsenal.
Yeah.
And they've got him in on loan, and he's kind of, I thought he'd come in and try and nail down a place, but he's coming out of the team. And they recalled a few players from loan. I know Plange, who done well for us when he played for Derby, actually, in the Championship. But they didn't do loads, because I think they did have a good squad. It was just getting the best out of them, wasn't it? And then they let a few out on loan, didn't they? Butland weirdly went to United just to fill the bench. And Ebouy, another one they got from Derby, went out the hole. So, yeah, a few bits and bobs. But I think they already knew what they had there, really, and it was just getting the best out of them.
Yeah, it certainly was. And look, we talked about clinicality before and the lack of it. And we're seeing a stat on screen from the other 14 that shows that Bournemouth's clinicality in terms of our shots versus our goals ratio is actually not too bad whatsoever. But another stat that we wanted to show you are the touches in the opposition penalty area. This is the season to week 35. Dom Solanke's right up there, but so is Wilfred Zaha as well, 146 and 135 respectively. It's fair to say that Zaha is always a menace against us, and he always, against most sides.
Yeah, he is.
Especially against us.
Yeah, that doesn't surprise me, them touches, because if you think about Zaha, when he picks up the ball, what a defender's going to do, they're going to back off. Mm. Because if you go too tight to him, he'll just do you. Mm. So I can see why they back off, and he gets into the box a lot of the time. So yeah, he's a good player, and I think he's one of them that he thrives off the fact that everyone boos him and says you're going to cry and all that.
Yeah.
And I've done it a few times, and then he's just went and beat three men, and he's a nightmare. And if it is Smithy who's playing against him, he's going to have a tough time, and I'll be backing a Smithy yellow card for sure. But yeah, he's a good player, and there's loads of, I know he did go and come back, but there's times where I thought he's probably going to leave, but he stayed there, and he's been crucial for him. So yeah, I know they love him there, and he is, as much as he's probably not the most likeable if you're not a Palace fan, he's deadly. And I always think, talking about the other 14 stats, I always think if you had to do some sort of thing where the best 11 outside of the main teams, I think he gets in most, doesn't he? He's a top player.
And we mentioned Eze as well, and this is the dribble success rate stats from the other 14, and he's right up there. Look at that, 60% success rate. We've not got a single player in that stat.
No, that doesn't surprise me too much, but I think what's interesting is the attempts he makes. That shows how much he tries to beat men.
Yeah,
he tries to take people on.
10.
That's a lot. I mean, is there only one that's more by the looks of it? Solly March.
Yeah.
So he obviously likes to try and take people on, which we've seen a lot. And he's just a really clever footballer, mate. So yeah, we're just going to have to watch them. But I think these players that were mentioned are at the top end of the pitch, so it's stopping that service to them as well, stopping it easy for them to get the ball to them players, hopefully.
In terms of team news, they've got a few players out injured at the moment, including James McArthur, James Tompkins and Nathan Ferguson.
Yep.
With AFC Bournemouth, Kiefer Moore should be available again. Otherwise, it's just the four we know about who are out injured.
Yeah,
the team news you can see going across the bottom of your screen now. Do you think that they're going to be using these three games to try things out at all? Or for instance, Vigna, probably going to be trying to work out whether he's going to sign permanently, maybe.
Yeah, of course. If Palace fans don't know, we've got left-back on loan from Roma, Mateus Vigna. And kind of hasn't played loads because he had a bit of an injury and we were doing okay and stuff. So we brought him in lately and he's got a few goals for us. And we kind of started him in the last game and it looks like we've got an option to buy. Mm. So we're just having a little look at him now. And he's one of them that it's going to be interesting because he's very attack-minded.
He does leave us exposed, though.
So he does leave us exposed. And it'll probably be Elise on that side, I would have thought. So and it wouldn't shock me if I was Roy Hodgson. I'd be thinking Zaha's capable of playing on both sides. I would maybe switch him now and again. keep Vigna, you know, if you put Zaha over there, go, let's try and catch Vigna out. Things like that. So that'll be really interesting to see. But he is good going forward. And
I think he's better off as a wing back. Probably. So he's got that protection. And it's handy having Kelly there. You can dig him out every time he makes an error.
But I think we've got to look at it positively and go, you know, no disrespect, but one of their right backs, as I mentioned, is going to be one of the ex-Bournemouth ones who are ageing. So as much as people think, well, Zaha could have a good time against Smithy, equally our left side should be able to cause, whether it be Ward or Klein, problems. So I think both teams will be, you know, throwing punches at each other, and you've got nothing really to lose, have you?
Mm. Do you want to know who the referee is?
Nah, I couldn't care less.
Really?
Yeah, I couldn't care less.
I'm going to tell you. It's Michael Salisbury. Do you know what that means?
Nope.
Okay, well, he's taken charge of three of our Premier League games this season. At home against Leicester.
Tick.
Away against Wolves.
Tick.
Away against Man United.
Are you...
And also, I'm sure there was a bit of VAR controversy in that as well.
I don't know, was there?
There was a goal that maybe shouldn't have been. Yeah. Also, the away League Cup match at Norwich.
Well, this season? Yeah. Oh, I love it. Yeah, I'll take that.
It was an... What was it?
Incy, wincy, teeny, weeny, super, wing back, Genesini. That's what I made up on
that
the day.
That would never work.
And then he went straight out alone, so I think they didn't want that to be chanting around the stadium. So, yeah. Okay, there you go.
Let's do teams. Alright, Crystal Palace then. We've got a 4-3-3, it looks like, Tom.
Yeah, pretty much. Like I say, it can morph into a 4-2-3-1, really, because one's going to be more advanced than the others. As I mentioned earlier, I'm going to stick with Johnson in goal, because since he's come in for Guaita, he hasn't done anything wrong, really, so I think he'll stay in. I think I'll go Ward right back. Could be Klein, but I think Ward's edging it at the moment, so I'll stick with him. Anderson and Guay, really good centre-half partnership. They'll stay in there.
I swear he made you one of your teams of the week in the Premier League show.
Yes, I think he probably did. I rate the pair of them, actually. And then Mitchell at left back, who's pretty impressive as well. In the midfield, as I say, I think Will Hughes might play this one. Mm. They've got a few options in there, to be fair, but I think they'll go with Hughes for his energy. Decore, good young player as well, a little bit more defensively minded. And then Eze, who will probably, equivalent to us, be like that Billing, who will try and get further forward and join the front three, which I think will be Elise on the right, Zaha on the left, and then I think they'll go with Ayew through the middle. Like I said, they've got a few options in there. Milivojevic occasionally plays. I'm just thinking for his age, he might drop out of this one. Hughes come in. They've got Edouard as well. So they've got a few options, but that's what I'm going to pump for, mate.
Okay, and then as for Bournemouth, similar lineup as well. Okay. Ooh. There's a surprise potentially brewing in this one.
If I get this right, it will look very clever from me. But I'm just, as you kind of briefly mentioned, mate, it's time to try things. We're trying Vigna because of that option to buy and stuff.
Will Dennis in goal?
No. He's not registered. 4-3-3, as I say, it can morph into a 3 quite comfortably. Neto will stay in goal. I think Smithy will have to play at right back. We haven't really got the other options. Vigna, as we said, will play left back. Kelly, I'm going to go Zavanyu. Yet to start a game. We bought him in January, if Palace fans don't know. Really highly rated young player. He hasn't had, his match fitness has been difficult because obviously he came from Ukraine and their football finished and then he had a few injuries. But at some point we're gonna have to have a look at him. I didn't think Senesi was brilliant in the last game. He's also had his injury problems. Mepham's also had his injury problems.
Yeah.
There could be a case for Stevens because he's on loan, we might look at him. But I just feel like if you're gonna give Zavani a try, it might be now.
Is he quick at all? Do you know?
I haven't really got a clue because we haven't really seen him.
I just wonder because it'd be helpful to Smith if he can help him out with Zaha on his tail all the time.
I just think I'm looking at the fixtures and kind of going, this could be a good one. Do you, no disrespect to Palace, of course, but do you start him like at home in his first game against Rashford potentially? Do you know what I mean? I think it just might be a nice game for him. I might be completely wrong, but I'm just going to, take a gamble and go for that. Yeah, I'll stick with the kind of normal three at the moment of Rothwell, Lerma and Billing. Be surprised if that changes. Christie, you can't take the shirt off him at the moment. Watara, I think, done enough to keep his place as well. And then Dom Solanke leading the line, mate. So that's what I'm going to go with.
Brilliant stuff. So, look, if you've got any predictions for this one, make sure you put them in the comments below. We do read every single comment and we'll be hearting the ones that we think could well be accurate. I mean, it's going to be the same as what I say, which is, are you ready? It's coming after Tom's.
Oh, I feel like I keep doing draws, but I'm going to do it again. I feel like, as we've mentioned a few times, both teams, nothing really to lose. Might as well have a go. No point of sitting back. Try and make some good entertaining football. And I think it'll be quite end-to-end. And I'm going to go for a 2-2 draw.
Right, you're going to go for 2-2, right. You know what it's going to be? Crystal Palace 1, Bournemouth 3.
Yeah, I told you. I was going out of the camera.
It's happening.
I know what you like.
It's happening. D from Back of the Nest is probably watching this. He's part of football's 12th man podcast with Dan Boss. By the way, check out that channel as well, because they'll do some reactions stuff on there as well. But I was nice with him, and I said a draw on his previous show, but I'm going to go 3-1, mate.
Oh, why not? 3-1
to Bournemouth. It's going to be a good away day, despite the fact we can't drink on the train, but it's all good. Look, safe travels when you go up there. Make sure you sing loud and proud. Let's get behind the team. Let's get behind Gary O'Neill as well. He's done a sterling job, and let's get 3 points.
Never doubt him. Never doubt him.
Never doubt him. Up the chairs. See you in the next one. See you so
much.
Gary O'Neill.
Never in doubt.
3-1.
Three one. You're a joke sometimes.